Since the dawn of agriculture, people have celebrated holidays to express their gratitude for bountiful crops. Thanksgiving is America's national harvest festival, and in October, Jewish families like the Steinbergs of Highland Park, Illinois, also celebrate the holiday of Sukkot. Sukkot commemorates the fall harvest in the Middle Eastern homeland of their forefathers. They build a backyard sukkah, a temporary shelter that reminds them of tabernacles, or portable tents, in which their nomadic ancestors lived and worshipped while they wandered in the desert. Jewish families will eat, and some may even sleep, in the sukkah for 8 days. A traditional sukkah is open to the sky and is covered with leafy branches for protection. Mort Steinberg built the sections of his sukkah several years ago, and his family helps reassemble them each fall. The Bible commands that Jews assemble 4 species of plants to accompany their sukkot prayers for a fertile year to come: the etrog, or citron, and the lulav, palm, myrtle, and willow branches all bound together, are the primary symbols of the holiday. Just before Sukkot, I went to an Orthodox neighborhood in Brooklyn, New York, where the 4 species are for sale.
An etrog is a citrus fruit. It's used by Jewish people at the festival of Sukkot or Tabernacles, and it is ordained by the Bible in the book of Leviticus. It says, "You shall take on this day the fruit of a goodly tree."
Where's the etrog from?
Originally, the etrog is the citron was from Northwest India. We believe that Jews brought the etrog with them to Europe and formed the basis of the citrus industry.
Sukkot is a harvest festival, and I know that one of the wishes is to have water. What does the etrog have to do with this wish for water?
The whole festival of Sukkot is tied in with the concept of rain. We say special prayers at the end of Sukkot for rain, and each of the 4 species, the palm branch, which is the lulav, the arava, which is the willow, the hadas, which is the myrtle, and the etrog, which is the citron, all require water for their growth.
Do you ever eat etrog?
One can eat the etrog. It is a custom by many after the festival of Sukkot to make etrog jam, marmalade.
Right, I've done that.
And also to serve it at the festival of Tu B'Shvat, which is the New Year for trees, which occurs roughly in February. People also candy the peel. They can cure it in brine. Those are other ways that people can eat the etrog or the citron. But there are also some medical applications that are described in the Talmud for stomach pains. There are also some beliefs that it helps to promote fertility among women.
Oh, really?
And may even be an aphrodisiac for men. But so there are a lot of different stories of, and customs. And one custom is that the etrog was in fact the fruit that Adam and Eve ate in the Garden of Eden. It was not an apple, but according to some opinions, it was the etrog.
The 4 species have meaning for Jews that go way beyond the harvest, as a Lubavitcher rabbi explained to me.
4 different species that we use on this holiday are actually very unique. We're focusing on the idea of unity of the different types of Jewish people. We have 4 different species. We have the citron, which is actually a very unique fruit that has a smell and it has a taste. We have a myrtle branch, which has a very unique smell. We have a date palm branch, which comes from a date tree, has a taste. The fruit has a taste, but does not have a smell. And we have the willow branch, which has no smell and no taste. And in the Jewish people, there are people that do a lot of good deeds, and there are people that study Torah, and there are people that do both, and there are Jews that do none. Mm-hmm. And it's important that we focus on the unity of the Jewish people, how it's important, how every single Jew is needed for the nation. Same idea how every single branch and species is needed for the mitzvah. If one of them is missing or is incomplete, the mitzvah is not fulfilled. Similar to the Jewish nation, we are one complete puzzle. If only one person, no matter what status he is in, is not united in a nation, the whole nation is lacking.
Whether they were farmers or city dwellers in medieval Europe, Jews continued to honor the religious calendar ordained by the Bible. Sukkot comes 5 days after Yom Kippur, and the first stake of the sukkah must be driven into the ground before the light fades from the last candle lit on Yom Kippur. While Mort Steinberg and his children were putting the final touches on their sukkah, I joined his wife Miriam in the kitchen to talk about some of the meals they would eat there.
Miriam, it looks like Mort and the kids have almost finished doing your sukkah. Is this your domain right here?
Absolutely, figuring out what to serve to hungry people outside, usually in the cold.
And you serve food for many days?
Many days. As a matter of fact, this year there'll be 2 days of holiday followed by Sabbath, so there'll be 4 meals in a row of company of 15 or more.
Wow.
And all of the food has to be prepared in advance, too, so it's quite a challenge.
What kind of dishes do you like to serve in the sukkah?
I like to serve hearty dishes, particularly dishes that are one bowl and easy to carry out in the sukkah, because everything that's made here has to be taken outside.
All right. Well, I always thought of food for the sukkah as harvest food, so that vegetable stuffed foods, aren't they traditional for?
I think they're very traditional, and in my family, stuffed cabbage was always served the first night of Sukkot as an appetizer.
Oh, as an appetizer.
As an appetizer.
In my family's main course.
Well, I that would save me a lot of trouble if everybody would just eat one course, but usually we have stuffed cabbage as an appetizer and then go on to something else.
What do you have as the main course then?
As the main course might be turkey or a baked chicken, but again, anything that I can do in a casserole type dish, it saves on the steps. The stuffed cabbage is a wonderful recipe because each step is very simple. We start by making a sauce which consists of
this is a very American stuffed cabbage recipe with cranberry sauce.
Yes, it is, and many people think that, that Sukkot is the model for the American holiday of Thanksgiving, so it works out nicely. Tomato sauce.
Should we mash up the cranberries, or what do you do?
We'll just whisk it all together when we're done pouring it in.
Tomato sauce.
Some water.
Drop
more. Brown sugar.
This is American.
Is sugar an American ingredient?
Well, brown sugar. I always
cranberries to go with the cranberry sauce. Raisins.
Because we like things really sweet and sour.
Chopped apple.
Harvest, clearly. Apple.
Clearly. And a little bit of lemon juice. And while I juice the lemon, I'm going to ask you to just stir everything all up.
I certainly will. Mash this up. All right. So
this
now
just goes on the stove to simmer while
there's one cranberry in there.
While we assemble the cabbage.
Here, let me throw this in for you.
Thank you.
And how long do you simmer that?
Really, just until it comes to a boil, which it will do while we're mixing the meat.
Okay.
And we do that by just mixing the meat together.
This is one of these wonderful dump and mix recipes.
Exactly,
isn't it?
Exactly. The hardest part is getting the leaves for the cabbage, for which I have to thank you, because of a trick I learned in one of your cookbooks of freezing the cabbage and letting it defrost naturally.
Oh, yeah. I learned that from a woman who was a wonderful baker in Massachusetts. We put in ground meat. What else did you put in?
Ground meat, egg, some rice that's not been cooked, some chopped onion, and some ketchup.
Clearly American. They didn't have that in Eastern Europe.
A little salt and pepper to taste. And now comes the task of separating the large outside cabbage leaves, which is what you use to roll. The larger they are, the larger the cabbage, the stuffed cabbage will end up to be. So this has been a cabbage that, according to your instructions, I cored and put in the freezer for several days. And then I let it defrost at least 24 hours. This is a big cabbage. This has actually been defrosting longer and is still a drop frozen on the inside. It is aromatic while it's defrosting, but
get used to that.
Get used to that. So is the cabbage once it's cooked.
Now, how much do you put in?
Well, I like them to match the size of the leaf. So probably about twice that for a leaf that size. And as we get more toward the center, they'll get smaller.
Okay. Just tell me if I'm doing it the way you like to do it.
Perfectly. Now, what I do is you fold the bottom.
Yeah.
Leaf crosswise.
Okay.
Fold the bottom up, the two sides.
It's like an envelope.
Just like an envelope. Straighten out. And we'll place it here waiting to go into the pot. Now, clearly the taking the cabbage leaves off the cabbage is the hardest part of this recipe. And it's not hard at all. It simply takes time.
Not doing a very good job here.
No one will know when it's put on their plate in the dark in Sukkot. They'll think it's delicious.
Okay, let's get...
Last one. Roll it up.
Into this envelope.
Just keep tucking the ends in.
And what's next? Tell
me. What's next? Well, we have the core of the cabbage a little bit left over. And what I like to do is just slice them up in small enough pieces that it will eventually get eaten.
Oh, that's a clever idea. I like that.
We'll put some of that with the sauce on the plate as we serve it. And this goes into the bottom of the pan to prevent anything from scorching for the long, slow cooking.
Good.
And then we simply line the pan.
With the open...
The seam side down.
Seam side down.
That will keep them together.
Oh, this is made about, looks like it's made more than 20.
Right. And the trick in terms of a pan is the wider is better than taller, I think.
For making these,
because that way they get more of the heat as well as some of the sauce.
Okay, here we go. Just perfect.
Okay, and then the last step is to take our sauce.
It's been simmering for about, 15 minutes or so?
For about 15 minutes, but it's just
doesn't
as...
Doesn't matter, really.
Doesn't really matter, just as long as
that looks so
you
pretty.
Need.
This would be good for Thanksgiving.
I suppose. You better stand back up there. Okay. There we go. Splashes.
This is my day for splashes, I think. All the same color. That looks really pretty.
Put some more on.
Here, do you want me to... Okay.
Thank you.
All right, you can smell it. Sounds smells so good.
You take it to the stove.
Do you cover it now, or will
no,
you wait?
No, I usually bring it to a boil and let everything settle.
Right.
And we'll bring it to a boil and then put it on low and simmer it for 2 hours, and then half hour uncovered in a 350 degree oven.
And that's it.
And that's it.
Oh, it looks bubbly and beautiful.
Love that smell.
I love the combination of the cranberries and the apples. And
would you like to have some now?
I absolutely would.
That looks great.
Can't even wait to sit in the Sukkot and eat it. I'll eat it right here.
Need some of the sauce.
Beautiful. Wonderful. Perfect balance of sweet and sour.
Since Sukkot is so connected to the grape harvest, many American Jews mark the holiday by making their own ceremonial wine.
Mort, you're one of the few people I know who makes his own Pesach wine. Can you tell me how you do it?
Well, we make a Concord grape, a very sweet Sacramento wine. The first step really is preparing the barrel for what comes later. The barrel is very important. It's an old barrel. It's probably 100 years old. My father-in-law can tell you more about it later. But it was used last year, so we have to clean it out and kill all the bacteria that's in it from last year. So the first thing we do is we take a sulfur stick like this, and we light it. Mm-hmm. We put it on just on some tin foil, and we put it in the barrel. Sulfur, of course, is a poison.
I can smell it, right.
That is burning, and that will kill all the bacteria that's in the barrel. We let this smoke for a pretty long time, maybe half an hour or so, and then the barrel will be ready. If we rinse it out, it'll be ready to take the juice that we have from our grapes.
I see. Huh. You've been doing this for a long time, right?
I've been doing it with my father-in-law for about... 22 years or so, and he has been doing it. He learned it from his father-in-law.
Really?
And he's been doing it for many years.
Now, where do you get these grapes from?
These grapes are from Stevensville, Michigan. They're usually available the end of September, beginning of October. Mm-hmm. Sukkot time, of course, is the harvest festival.
Right.
And the grapes are one of the symbols of the harvest. What we do here is we take the grapes and we push it, put them all into the water, and we rinse them off.
Okay. And this one too?
Let's do one at a time.
Okay.
And then rinse them off, and then we'll pick them off the stems.
One by one.
One by one. If you leave the stems, we find that it leaves a bitter taste in the wine.
What does the word sukkah mean exactly?
Sukkah, it's a booth, a shelter, a temporary structure. A kosher sukkah needs at least three walls.
Yeah.
And it has to have a temporary roof. The roof has to be made only of materials which are grown in nature, unprocessed. In other words, you can't have a plywood roof, even though it's made out of wood. But you can have bamboo, pieces of bamboo, or as we do, which is very common, boughs of trees, of evergreens, because they look nice and they keep the color throughout sukkah.
We're in Chicago, which is
usually windy,
and it's a little bit windy today, but it's also very often cold at this time of year. So
well, it's interesting. The question is, why is sukkah in the fall and not during the nice weather of the summer? And the answer usually is given is because it's not easy to be Jewish. If it was during the summer, it wouldn't be, I guess, as big of a mitzvah as it is in the fall.
We're finished washing. What's next?
Well, we finished these last few grapes, and then we will crush. Let's get all these grapes up. Then we'll crush the grapes to break the skins so the juice can come out.
Okay. You get it?
We get it.
Ooh, it's heavy.
And traditionally, my daughter helps crush. Can you come over, Shira?
Shira. What a beautiful name. What does that mean?
Music and song.
In Hebrew, right?
Yeah.
Why don't you hold that and then start crushing?
This looks like an old crusher. How old is this?
My father-in-law says that this is 85 years old at least.
Wow.
The grapes are being crushed, which means that the skins are being split so that the juice can run out. And this is now called must, which is the skins and the juice. Watch your fingers. Hold it. Okay, hold it. And this will, now we'll let sit. Okay, well now let's sit. Here.
How long will you let it sit?
For at least a week.
Wow.
This is the freshly squeezed grapes and the juice, but it's unfermented. That has to ferment, as this bucket has, for a week. This was prepared earlier. And so you can see the dark purple color caused by the fermenting and the rich, rich color.
You can smell the fermentation and with the bubbles.
Right. Now what we do with this is we have to siphon the juice out, which we do here. Do it hard. Mm. There you go.
Mm.
Keep going.
Is that all right? It's sweet tasting.
Well, it should be sweet.
Well, I thought it wouldn't be that sweet because I know Concord you need to add a lot of sugar to. So you siphon all of it off.
Siphon it off as much juice as possible, and the balance then we'll put in the press, and we'll press it and squeeze out the remaining juice.
And then it just squeezes it.
Yeah, you could push down in here on the juice and the grapes. Really.
Oh, good. My hands are nice and red.
This stains. Okay, we'll get about everything in there. And then we build this up like this. And then this goes around until it hits.
And just presses it down.
And then it'll press
it down. No feet, right?
No feet. That's for the movies.
Wow, look at this. It's really
I guess this beats using your feet.
You can see this is squeezing
it's
out.
It's really squeezing out now. How long do you do this until there's no more juice?
Yeah, it'll go down. It'll be very compacted.
So it takes about how many minutes to do this?
Just another couple minutes.
Oh, that's great. It smells so good.
Open this up. You can still see we could have gone some more. There's still
right.
a lot of juice
yeah,
in there.
Yeah, there definitely is.
And so we're left with this kind of a cake thing here.
Want me to take it?
Take this apart.
Very methodical.
Which is what's left. And then this is more juice, which we pour right into the barrel.
I got you here. Let me take this off for you. Beautiful color.
Now, add the sugar.
Okay. And you won't tell me how much.
Well, we're going to add today, I'll add 5 pounds.
Yeah.
Any kind of this white sugar. Sometimes I would add more, it depends. These are particularly sweet Concords. So I'm just going to add 5 pounds right in.
Okay. And you mix it up or not?
Yeah.
Oh, you have that long pole.
And you have to mix this a lot because, as you can imagine, the sugar takes a long time to dissolve.
Later that evening, we sat down in the sukkah to sample wine along with Miriam's father, Mort Bernstein.
The barrel that you saw earlier, I bought about 45 years ago. You used to be able to get wooden barrels in certain types. This happens to be known as a pickle barrel, believe it or not. You never use it from pickles, but you needed the big opening on the top so you can get your hands in and work with it. My first batch was a little 2-gallon barrel that I bought, and I thought it was great. I had some Italian friends drink it and they spit it on the floor because this was a real sweet wine.
Uh-huh.
I did the same with theirs. It was so sour I couldn't get it down. My early days, my grandfather had a little sukkah, no lights, no windows, and you ate your dinner there. It could rain like crazy, and I can still see the rain running down the faces, but you ate.
Every night.
Every night.
To learn more about Jewish cooking in America with Joan Nathan, visit us online at www.pbs.org. Companion products for Jewish cooking in America, including Joan Nathan's updated cookbook, a CD of the music score, and a 2-hour video of series highlights and recipes, are available by calling 1-800-235-3000. Credit cards are accepted. Jewish Cooking in America with Joan Nathan is made possible by the Joseph S. and Diane H. Steinberg Charitable Trust, proud supporters of the arts, children's causes, and the preservation of Jewish heritage. And by Hebrew National, proud sponsors of Jewish Cooking in America, serving you and your family traditional kosher franks and delicatessen products since 1905. Hebrew National, we answer to a higher authority.
And by Lender's Bagels. Our idea of a perfect day is warm and comforting and satisfying all around. Lender's Bagels, the perfect circle.
And by the following private individuals and family foundations.
Thank you.
This has been a co-production of Joan Nathan, Frappe Productions, and Maryland Public Television.
This is PBS.